So, despite the fact that we're apparently more connected than at any other time in history via the internet, via our smart devices, more people say that they feel lonely than ever before. For several decades now, social scientists have been asking people this question: how many close connections do you have in your life? Meaning people that you would turn to if you were really in a crisis. When they first began asking that question, the answer was on average 3. In 2004, the answer was none. None. Heartbreaking. And loneliness is extremely painful. Physically painful. When you feel lonely, your heartbeat increases, your system is under stress, it releases cortisol, which is your stress hormone. And in keeping with the findings of the study that Duane discussed, all kinds of health outcomes are result from that. They've done studies from everything from just the common cold, where they expose people who are lonely and feeling disconnected, as well as those who say, I have a strong relationship network, to the cold virus. The people who are more lonely are 3 times more likely to get sick. And the same is true of diseases. The people who are disconnected are more likely to have a fatal outcome from diseases, period. So this isn't just a mental, emotional thing, it's literally a physical thing as well. And on a psychological level, disconnection leaves people feeling more anxious, pessimistic. We end up with low self-esteem, and we're much more likely to become depressed. We are literally wired for connection as human beings, biologically. And here is the deal with this. The only reason that we are all here right now is because way back on the savannas of Africa, our ancestors figured out how to work collectively together. That is how we survived. Because human beings, if you take a look around, we are not equipped to survive on our own. We are not grizzly bears, we are elephants.
And it went further than that because ants also work together. Right? They also work together. In fact, a lot of mammals and insects have learned how to group together in order to survive. But we are unique, and so we're in the same category as dolphins and elephants and whales, who also have sentimentality. We have a need to have sentimentality, to care and to love, and to be loved. That's a very unique blend where we actually form societies and consider other as well as self in order to stay connected, not just to shelter ourselves because we're better and we can hunt better in groups, but actually we need real sentimentality in our lives.
And just to bring it back to this idea of anxiety and depression, the reality is when you found yourself disconnected from your tribe on the savannas of Africa, out there on your own, it is totally appropriate to feel terrified because there are predators lurking in those bushes, right? This is biology's way of saying, holy crap, you're in danger. Where is your tribe? Go find your tribe. And that's appropriate. And we remain with that wiring in our system. When we are disconnected, we are in a holy crap. I am in a state of I might not survive in my body. So in this picture, what is that little boy in the red t-shirt feeling? So, here is the deal. Again, a social science experiment. We show this picture to Western cultures, Canadians, Americans, Britons, etc. They say that boy feels happy. We show it to people from Asian cultures, growing up in those countries. They say that boy feels sad. Because from that particular cultural mindset, they can't imagine that this boy would be surrounded by sadness and still feel happy. And when we're studying happiness, what we have found is if you give a whole bunch of people a simple directive and say, I want you to focus on making yourself happier this year. Do whatever you can, take whatever opportunities you can to make yourself happier. This works in many cultures, except in Western cultures.
How come? Serving our individuated sense of self as our own preoccupation will never and does not deliver any sense of fulfillment or longstanding happiness. Despite right. the fact that we have been trained and sold this notion for so many decades. It only happens when we're actually feeling connected to another human being, legitimately.
So the things that Westerners would do to pursue happiness are based on a very individualistic framework of reference, and it doesn't produce happiness.
So pursuing our individual goals in life will never lead to happiness because we are not just individuals. This is the great Western myth. So our book, Real, is kind of interesting, will be found in the self-help section. And we were just chuckling about that today, that it's even called self-help instead of what? We help, you know? Right?
The Power of Authentic Connection on the self-help section. And that's how we think about it, right? When you come to a counselor, often you are coming there thinking there's a problem lurking deeply inside my psyche that I alone need to fix. Not so. At the root of this horrible sense of disconnection is the fact that most adults are walking around profoundly disconnected from themselves in three really, really important ways. From feeling, from our emotional experience, from our story, our sense of who we are, including how it connects with everybody else's story, and out of that, from a sense of our own legitimate values, we detach from what matters most, and we replace what instinctively and fundamentally matters most. If you ask most people what's important, they will say family. If you watch what most people do, not so. Right? We detach from what matters most in terms of what guides our principles.
So, positive and transpersonal psychology have contended that we enter this world with a unique core or soul, or kind of like a seed. James Hillman, I don't know if any of you are familiar with James Hillman, he wrote a book called The Soul's Code, and he postulates, it's called his acorn theory, that we really come in like as an acorn with an idea of who we are already as an oak tree, and that the development of this self to become the oak tree, or the development of our soul to become ourselves, our true self, needs its soil and water is actually connection in order to fuel its growth properly and nurture the aspect of actually who we are to become what we truly are. Yeah.
So our story for all of us literally begins with connection. We're wired emotionally to experience love and connection before we are wired to think as human beings. As soon as we enter this world, the first part of our system to get wired up is our emotional system, because in part it facilitates bonding with our caregivers. How many parents do we have in the room? This does not happen universally. However, a extremely common experience is when you first, this little being of yours first enters the world, you are astonished by the crazy amount of love that you feel for this little being. And that feeling is what we're talking about. That is what is getting that little being started to become wired for their own sense of self. The thinking brain doesn't start to kick in until later, around age 5 or 7. And we operate primarily through our emotions, through this medium of love and connection, all throughout our childhoods. This thing is not actually in control. It's more our sense of, our feeling sense of who we are. And do we belong? And are we safe? And are we connected?
And our way of actually communicating that we're connected is very, very, very subtle. With children and infants, pre-language, it's all about mirroring to each other that this caring is a fact. And there's all kinds of subtle cues going on between mother, particularly in the early years, and the infant. It is so subtle, it comes down to mirror neurons in our system that we exchange through messaging, through nonverbal communication, facial expressions, tone and voice, and all kinds of subtle mannerisms. And this is so, so important, because I was working with a client a few months back who was breastfeeding her child, her infant. And she says, you know, I'm breastfeeding my child. And she was describing it. She says, and it's really neat because I can also text on the telephone. I'm nurturing my child and I'm texting. And I said, do you realize that the milk is one thing, but looking up at you is another? And she just had no idea that that really mattered in that moment, that she was just physically nurturing her child.
So we're going to actually show you a little clip that will demonstrate this with infants. And the reason we're showing it to you is because it happens in an adult version too.
I just want to add too on that for the fellow that clapped there. I mean, just think, that's just the infant and the child. But we're actually children as adults walking through life all day long looking for the eye contact and little mannerisms and hellos and grunts and groans and awareness of each other while we're sitting there at the bus stop and everybody's on their cell phones, cutting out really important messaging as us as a social society caring for each other.
So this experiment is by a guy named Ed Tronick, and he is one of the founders of something called attachment theory in psychology. And it's really a simple little experiment that will demonstrate this to you. You'll first of all see mom interacting with her child in a really active way, the way that we often instinctively do. And then she's instructed to hold her face still. So just watch and see what happens here.
In this still face experiment, what the mother did was she sits down and she's playing with her baby who's about a year of age.
I'm like a girl. Oh.
And she gives a greeting to the baby. The baby gives a greeting back to her.
Yeah.
This baby starts pointing at different places in the world, and the mother's trying to engage her and play with her. They're working to coordinate their emotions and their intentions, what they want to do in the world. And that's really what the baby is used to. And then we ask the mother to not respond to the baby. The baby very quickly picks up on this. And then she uses all of her abilities to try and get the mother back. She smiles at the mother. She points because she's used to the mother looking where she points.
Yeah.
The baby puts both hands up in front of her and says, what's happening here? She makes that screechy sound at the mother, like, come on, why aren't we doing this? Even in this 2 minutes when they don't get the normal reaction, they react with negative emotions, they turn away, they feel the stress of it, they actually may lose control of their posture because of the stress that they're experiencing.
Okay. I'm here. And what are you doing? Oh, yes. Oh, what a big girl.
Yeah. So that was just a tiny little moment.
And please don't punish yourself if you think if your parents out there, oh, my God, there was moments like that and I wasn't there. The wasn't there part isn't nearly as important as coming back and repairing it. And also, I mean, this doesn't happen to have to happen 100% of the time. One of our local child specialists in child development, Gordon Neufeld, who I used to work with years ago, postulated that we only have to really be on 30% of the time in order to maintain that connection that the child knows it's there. And yet that I'm sure you could just feel that, the power of that, how much horror can actually be instilled in a matter of seconds. And how we as adults, in the moment of difficulty with our partners, actually in fear of danger of being seen, have a steel face.
Because the reality is adults respond every bit as badly to that. Most of us would rather have somebody express anger than to have that blank. The feeling of not being able to read is really distressing.
And yet that will trigger off things inside that conflict, and you end up arguing about who knows what. But at a real primal level, there's a signal, like, I'm not letting you, I'm not giving you anything. I don't care. I don't want to be read, so you're not going to be able to see me. Powerful.
So in those kinds of early moments of disconnection, it can be so long-term damaging. If you can imagine those moments now moving into the realm of trauma, when a child is abused or not abused sexually, emotionally in some way, like that kind of disconnection really separates you from your inner sense of who you are. And it can happen in a severe moment, and it can happen over repeated little patterned moments where disconnection is never repaired. And in those moments, literally, because we feel like we're disconnected from the love that we need to survive, we are filled with terror, we don't have the cognitive ability to understand what's happening, and we make it mean something horrible about ourselves. This is happening because I am bad. There is something wrong with me. I'm flawed in some way. I'm not good enough. I'm not lovable. And because we have nowhere to go with our distress, and at the end of Tronick's experiment, the little baby had somewhere to go with her distress. That's what actually made it okay. When we have nowhere to go, all we can do is lock those feelings down and push them away. And that's what we call the basement. We push our own felt emotional experience away so that we can do what we need to do to survive.
And what we push down there is this belief that we must be bad and wrong. That just becomes a fact.
Often when we talk about this, we tell our own stories as well. Tonight we want to focus on something a little different, so we won't be doing that. But if you don't know us and you want to hear our stories, come back. So we separate thinking from feeling in those moments because the feeling is so painful. And it is the feeling that gives these mistaken thoughts that much power in our basement. And this separation of emotion from logic is the thing that afflicts most adults walking around in the world today. We have a certain intellectual understanding of who we are from our self-help section. Self-help section. And that differs from how we feel about ourselves. And we end up in this internal argument trying to convince ourselves, trying to talk ourselves into feeling something different.
Which just reinforces the problem. I should feel better. Look what I have, which is possibly true. But another part of you is absolutely convinced that you're bad and wrong and not okay, unworthy, and detached. And it just becomes the baggage you end up carrying throughout your life.
And here is the irony. When you disconnect from yourself in this way, you become extremely self-obsessed.
Yeah.
It is all internal about me. What do I need to feel okay? What is wrong with me? Our universe, as we disconnect from others and shut ourselves away, becomes all about me.
I remember years ago we had this, went to Sweden to teach a workshop, and this person came in and was so self-obsessed. She was the only person that actually didn't take the workshop because she had to have the seat just right. She had it was like a campground around her chair of all her needs and her dietary special things. And she breathed a certain way during the whole, she closed her eyes and she was tapping, doing that thing, and all kind just spent the whole weekend in self-care.
She didn't let us help her at all.
Not a bit. You got too close to her, just even said hello, and the tone wasn't right. I'm caring for myself. I wish you would talk to me differently.
Extreme version of what we're talking about, but true, true story. So into this world, da-da-da-da, what comes? Social media. Social media, like the junk food for connection.
That's good.
And here it is, our intense desire for connection. We aren't getting the connection that we need. And so we can't bear to put these devices away. We can't bear to log off. We need our likes.
Because no matter how much you get, it isn't enough. How many likes do you have before it feels okay when you look at somebody else's Facebook site? Oh, they got more likes. They got more. What do they do to get more? Do I have to have another picture? What do I have to do? How come they're not commenting? Maybe if I comment, they could get me. Oh, yeah, that's what I'll do. I'll like them, and maybe they'll like me. And no matter what, how many you get, it's never enough. It's insidious.
I don't know if any of you were watching the news this morning, but there's a guy who managed to turn a whole flight, a whole WestJet flight, on its way to Jamaica around.
Did you see that?
Because he got up and claimed that he had coronavirus.
Just to make something viral.
So he could get a lot of action. He was making a viral video.
And he's now remorseful because he later realized, you know, this isn't just a cool little joke that people are going to laugh at for a minute. And he gets all his likes later on. No, this plane was on its way to Madrid and it had to land in Jamaica. Yeah.
It was on its way to Jamaica and it came back to Canada.
No, it was on its way to Madrid.
No. Jamaica.
Was it? Oh, gee. Oh, gee. Close. Oh, dear. Jet lag.
The kind of connection we need is exactly what was happening between that mother and child.
And what happens every morning with Catherine and I when we're having our morning coffee?
Yeah. Totally. It's first thing, as soon as we get up, this is us. Gazing into each other's eyes like that.
Well, I mean, sometimes we do.
Not really first thing in the morning.
I make the coffee, and, you know, I wait for that little emoji, Naz, from her. Like, not just coffee. And thank you, Duane. That was awfully nice of you. In fact, I really appreciate that you make coffee for me every morning. I love that about you.
And I also love when you put chocolates on my pillow.
Oh, thank you. I do.
Which he does every night, which is very sweet. But back to the point that we were starting to make here.
They probably want to know more about all this.
The kind of connection we need is exactly what was happening with that mother and child. We need to see ourselves being seen, to hear ourselves being heard, and to feel ourselves being felt. That's literally how we root ourselves in our own identity. That's how a child grows their identity, is by being seen in that way, and that's how we rediscover that identity as adults as well.
Tell them about that tribe that doesn't wake up at night, the Nuris.
Oh. I don't want to.
Oh, you don't want to?
No.
Okay. Just thought it was a good idea. No, sorry.
Okay. Do you want me to tell that?
yeah.
Duane wants me to tell you about that. Because I was obviously on study mode to get this on this particular topic, obviously doing research up the wazoo. So I discover that the Hutterites, now there's a lot of things that are not okay about the Hutterites. They're a very traditional Christian community. They live in deliberately in an undeveloped way. And so they never go any further from their home base than they can get by a buggy. So they are like a tribal culture. So despite the fact that there are many things that are not okay, such as the way that women are treated, they have lower levels of depression and anxiety. And we've measured this in part by observing their sleeping patterns. When people are feeling anxious and depressed, they have many micro wakes every morning, right? Or all through the night. They just wake up, go back, wake up, go back, wake up, go back. The Hutterites sleep straight through. And that's because they have the feeling that somebody has their back, as we did in our tribes. We can rest when somebody has our back. We can relax when somebody has our back. We feel safe when we're in connection.
Yeah, I'd like to say a little bit more about that sense of safety and knowing somebody has your back. You know that they know your unique self. That's really pivotally important, that true self has a place. It is being seen. It is being understood. It is being nourished. It is being held. Even when Tronik was describing that baby, I imagine he'd be a good father. Do you hear his tone of his voice, how he just understood that child? However,
this is you.
Do you want me to do it? That's okay. We can both do it together. I like doing it with you. It's kind of fun. She gives me little cues as we're talking. Watch her hand throughout the lecture because she's letting me know whether I just went off track or not.
No, because I look at her time right now.
However, when you have a basement, it can be scary because the seat is here. A personal involvement. Okay. However, you have a basement, and it can be scary to be seen in the way we need to be seen.
Right? When you have a basement, that feeling of being seen, being heard, being felt can be, oh, crap.
Because as personal emotional investment increases in your relationships, so then does vulnerability. Like, it only happens with those that you've invested emotionally in, that you're going to feel that vulnerability because they have power now. Because when something is important, we feel vulnerable. And when someone is important, we get scared. And when we get scared and anxious, we see more things to be anxious about. So it becomes a reinforcing cycle. You start noticing what you're looking for, danger, danger, and you start becoming in relationship with danger instead of the person's true self. We see what we're looking for. So as vulnerability increases, so does relational problems. Because we do not know how to handle our feelings of vulnerability, particularly in the Western world when we've been so self-serving. We don't see it modeled. Vulnerable parents, vulnerable societies, vulnerable leaders, vulnerable State of the Union addresses. I'll stop there on that one.
Thank you, Duane.
We revert to hiding and defending it and strategizing it around it instead of developing the courage to care. Because we need courage to care because we're going to feel vulnerable. Not just the need and not just for the benefits, but to get to know the territory of courage and caring. What does it actually mean? It requires a decision, folks. Not just an understanding, but action. What stops us from acting on courage? And, you know, in my mind, I think all of us would be have the courage to care if we actually knew who we're dealing with. And on social media, the way we construct our lives and our attention spans, we don't know each other to care. If we knew somebody, we would care. So if we actually knew, we would. But because we don't know each other anymore, we have like numerical numbness with the tragedies in the world. The headlines, it's like our attention to actually study what's going on in the world is so short, we change the channel because we feel uncomfortable.
Are we going to do this? Or are we going to skip it?
No, it's coming right there.
Okay.
See that? You're ahead of me. You went off course. Did anybody notice that? I was on track, and she wasn't. We're getting there, dear.
Nazreen and I were mirror-neuroning each other.
And I was on a roll there. Do you hear my voice?
Because they're just seeing a big black hole right now.
That's okay. That's all right. It's there. The video is there.
I know it's there, so, but they don't
but
know it's there.
But this numerical numbness, even with the flight 752, was that 752? You know, initially, the news with all the political games that were going on with the U.S. assassinating the Iran military leader, and then the Iranians coming back with hitting the plane, and the Iran's denying they did it, and the U.S. denied they had anything to do with it, and on it went. Meanwhile, there was 78 people dead. And I remember watching it, and I got caught up in the politics of it, too, until I was watching CBC one night, and they started interviewing some of the families. They became people. They became people. We don't see people very often. We see, even walking down the street with somebody, a street person, we see a problem. Don't bother me, or it's too overwhelming, or I don't know if I trust you to give help. Like, we don't see them as people, we see them as problems. If we actually stopped long enough to sit down beside the person and hear their story, you'd probably want to take them home and cook them dinner. And so this courage to care happens when we actually see another human being. And we want to show you a clip.
Now we have amazing video to show you of a rescue in Paris. An immigrant from Mali is being called a real-life Spider-Man after he rescued a child dangling from a balcony. Look at this. You can see Mamoudou Gassama, that's his name, scaling four floors, pulling himself up from balcony to balcony until he makes it to the four-year-old and pulls him to safety from midair. I'll just give you a moment to get to that point. Now, CNN affiliate BFM TV reports that French President Emmanuel Macron has invited him to the Élysée Palace on Monday.
And that's just one example of where your natural impulse would go when you follow your own courage to care. And the other place that requires courage in terms of actual connection is to let ourselves be vulnerable where we are vulnerable. To actually let ourselves be seen in the places where we hurt instead of hiding them, pretending, strategizing, defending. And this feeling of being seen, of being known in the places that we hurt is what pulls us out of the basement and back into connection, is what allows us to change our felt sense of who we are from the basement experience. When we're brave enough to let ourselves be completely vulnerable and be seen and we receive care, that changes how we feel about ourselves. So now what I know to be true in my head matches what I feel. And that is the experience of the awakening. That picture is obviously with permission used from a moment in our awakening workshop. If Duane and I have any skill, and we do, it is in helping people to become vulnerable. Once we're vulnerable, our natural inclination for connection is activated. We care. That's just human. That requires no therapeutic magic whatsoever. And that connection then reconnects us with who we truly are. And that acorn self, that authentic self, has a chance to start growing and becoming again.
And here is an example of one from our last workshop just in London.
Should we tell them a minute?
Okay, so I've decided to be fully vulnerable and record a video of myself to let you know how I've been feeling, because I can't hide behind my phone any longer. It's driving me mad. For years I've suffered with anxiety, really horrible anxiety. As a kid I was happy-go-lucky, though inside I was suffering, because I was scared to death of death itself. It crippled me for decades. The anxiety really kicked in when I was a kid, and I know the trigger too, but I won't bore you with that story. It was such a minor thing, but it was enough to ruin my childhood. Then when I was 17, my dad died. My whole world caved in, and I spent years in denial about him dying. Eventually, after living with anxiety for more than 30 years, my wife Sam persuaded me to get some help. Talking to a counsellor and using CBT was incredible, and I thought I felt better, though somehow I managed to ditch one anxiety and replace it with another one. The feeling of not being enough. Trouble is, social media seemed to amplify my anxiety. More and more I measured my self-worth on the number of likes and hearts I got from a post. I guess the likes became like a value system, which I needed to feel good about myself. Though the sad part was, no matter how many likes I got, it was never enough and I still felt rubbish. Then I would feel even more anxious and depressed when I'd start scrolling through my feed. Everyone seemed to have bigger following, more likes, better photos, more comments. They were going to nicer places than me. I was suffering from massive FOMO. I felt increasingly isolated and alone. I noticed other physical deteriorations too. My memory was an embarrassment. My concentration levels were rubbish. And at night, my sleep was broken. I often woke, like in hot sweats, not even knowing why I was awake. Then I'd wake up at the crack of dawn, normally about 5 or 6, and already feel drained. And it was all because of the likes. So many people across this beautiful planet of ours are now looking for likes. Likes have become the new social currency. And the fear of missing out has reached epidemic proportions. 40% of people aged 18 to 34 say they experience FOMO. Social media has become a new way of keeping up with the Joneses, and it's eaten my soul for years. Likes are that little kick of serotonin that's supposed to be like nourishment for the soul, except they worked in the opposite way for me. They were causing me so much pain. I was becoming more and more anxious, stressed, and depressed, constantly comparing myself to the amazing people I was following. So when my incredible friend Paul recommended a workshop which might help me, I thought there was no harm in trying. Paul went on the workshop 7 years ago and it changed his life forever, and said it was the single best decision he'd ever made. So anyway, I'll cut to the chase. The workshop happened last weekend. It was called The Awakening. And after 3 days of crying, of recounting my childhood trauma, and hearing other people recount their traumas, I began to feel better. The people who run, or the couple who run that workshop, healed me with their words and their actions. After 3 days in that room, I walked out of the workshop a completely different person. I felt lighter, more alive, more fearless. No longer did I worry about rubbish. My goal at the workshop was to live life without fear, and amazingly, I achieved it. It's been a week since that workshop, and I still feel absolutely amazing. And like Paul, it was one of the best decisions I'd ever made. It's taken me a week to collect my thoughts, though I've decided that I'm not prepared to compare myself to others anymore. In real life, but especially on social media. If I only have 10 likes and no comments, I'm okay with that. Mark Twain said that the comparison is the death of joy, and he was right. Comparing yourself to other people is totally ludicrous and something I'm not prepared to do anymore. Anyway, I think that's it for now. I just want to say hey and tell you where my head is at. So starting from today, no more self-comparison and a lot more self-love. Anyway, love from me, from a place of vulnerability. And before I go, a massive shout out to Duane and Catherine O'Kane and the rest of the incredible ClearMind team. The Awakening Workshop changed everything to me. And I can't thank them enough for helping me to work through my fears and make me realise it's okay to visit the anxieties in my basement. Bye.
And, I mean, who would think, right, 3 days of crying and I began to feel better. We get up here, we give these talks every month, and it is a difficult thing to describe that it actually works. That picture that I showed you, where's my girl? This actually feels good, even when you're in the middle of intense pain. To finally have somebody see you actually feels good. That's probably a really, really weird concept for anyone who has not experienced it, but it is true. And that is what allows us, as it did with Jay, back, to shift our felt experience. Because when we're shoving our feelings down, you're not going to feel alive. You can't. You're actively pushing your feelings away. Connection, real connection is key, and it requires the courage to care, including actively expressing and extending that love, as we had you do right from the outset. So we want to end tonight with a song, because it actually, out of this experience in Ireland, in Cove, we were discussing the heartbreak around the people who would have had to immigrate. And Tom, our person who was taking care of us in Ireland, shared with us a very traditional song that is sung specifically on that theme of saying goodbye to people who are going away. And it's called The Last Glass,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
Now, when I looked this up in Wikipedia, he won't like this part. Claims it's a Scottish song and not an Irish song.
There's pipes in it.
But we won't tell Tom that part.
Yeah. Everybody agreed? You're not Tom Carey.
Tom, he's in court. Don't
do see
tell
him.
Him.
Do not mention that.
Of all the money that e'er I had, I spent it in good company. And all the harm I've ever done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be to you all. So fill to me the parting glass and drink a health whate'er befalls. Then gently rise and softly call, good night and joy be to you all. Of all the comrades
sides that it I had. They're sorry for my going away and all the sweethearts that e'er I had. They'd wish me one more day to stay. But since it fell into my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and softly call good night and joy be to you all. Hail to me the parting glass, and drink a health whate'er befalls. And
so that is the energy we want you to take back into your lives, back into the people that you care about the most. Thanks for your time and attention.